Hi everyone, Aaron here for Zolotech, and today Apple released iOS 15.4 Beta 1. This is available to developers and hopefully soon to public beta testers. And you'll see it came in at a very large 5.37 gigabytes. That's on my iPhone 13 Pro Max, and anytime you go from a public version of iOS 15.3 to a new beta or back to a regular version, it's going to reinstall the entire OS and will be a large install. Now, it was about the same size on all the devices here, the iPhone 11, the iPhone 10, and I'm still installing it on the iPhone 6S Plus. This has been installing for over an hour at this point, so if you have a 6S, 6S Plus, or SE, don't be surprised if it takes that long, but it was between 4 and 6 gigabytes. Now, Apple also released iPadOS 15.4 Beta 1 that I have here on the 12.9-inch iPad Pro from 2021, along with watchOS 8.5 Beta 1, tvOS 15.4 Beta 1, and macOS 12.3 Beta 1. And this is a pretty exciting update with features we've been looking forward to for a while. Now, let's first take a look at the build number and then talk about what's new. So we'll go to Settings, then General, then About. You can see the build number is 19E5209H. So we're probably a little ways out when it comes to betas. We'll probably have three or four of them before a final release. Now, as far as anything new, well, the first thing new is there's a modem update. On the iPhone 13 Pro Max, it went to modem update version 1.55.00. So there's a modem update. So if you were having connectivity issues or switching between 5G, 5G UC, LTE, or anything like that, hopefully this has improved even more. Now, the first new thing that's in this update is under Settings. If we go under Settings, go to Face ID and Passcode, put in our passcode, you'll see that it says use Face ID with a mask. Now we could do this before using an Apple Watch, but now we can do this without an Apple Watch. So it says Face ID is most accurate when it's set up for full face recognition only. To use Face ID while wearing a mask, iPhone can recognize the unique features around the eye area to authenticate. You must be looking at your phone to use Face ID while wearing a mask. If we turn that on, you'll see that it says use Face ID with a mask or don't use it with a mask. So we can use it with a mask and now we can set it up. So first position your face in the camera, then move it around. So we can do that and you'll see I'm not wearing a mask. So it says your face must match the existing Face ID appearance. So make sure it's already set up, then go ahead and place a mask on. It can also work with glasses, but we'll try again. It says remove your mask in a safe environment to set up Face ID. So it's going to guide you in every way possible to get this to be accurate. So you'll see now, position your face, we'll set it up. And then give it a moment to rescan. It says done. And we only had to scan once. Now we have the option to add glasses. So you saw that I was wearing glasses there just a moment ago. I'll put my glasses back on. They're just for reading. And it says add glasses. Using Face ID while wearing a mask works best when it's set up to recognize each pair of glasses you wear regularly. Face ID will work with a mask or with a mask, doesn't support sunglasses. We'll hit continue and get started. And again, it's looking for those glasses. Move your head again. And now it's set up and it says complete. So now we should be able to unlock the phone while wearing glasses and a mask. So let's try that. We'll put the face mask back on. We'll lock the phone, pick it up, and it unlocks right away. Nothing coming from my watch. It's not jiggling, letting me know. It's doing it directly from the phone. Again, unlock, and it works right away. So this is something I think a lot of people have been waiting for. It's a great addition and a huge feature update for those of us that need to wear a mask every day or have glasses and a mask. It should help a lot. Apple has added a new widget to iOS 15.4. So if we go over to our widgets, go to edit, we'll add a new one, scroll all the way down, and you'll see there's a new wallet widget. This will give you a quick glance at your Apple Card balance, and this is a generic placeholder. The balance will be accurate if you have it tied to your account. This phone doesn't have the Apple Card on it, and then you can just add it, and it will tell you to add your Apple Card in Wallet if you don't already have it set up. So you've got that new widget in this update. They've also added a bunch of emoji to bring us up to Unicode standard 14. So version 14 adds 37 emoji with different colors as well, but you can see here's all the new ones here, from a melting face to palms facing left and right, biting your lip. You've got eggs with or eggs within a nest. You've got a jar, an x-ray, bubbles, ID, an equal sign, and more. So all of those are added in 15.4. You can see all of them here, the 37 different ones. And then of course there's color variations on some of these. So those have been updated in 15.4 and are available there. Now, one of the most exciting things has to do with iPadOS and macOS, and that's Universal Control. Universal Control is now active in macOS 12.3 Beta 1 and iPadOS 15.4 Beta 1. If you have both of those betas installed, you'll be able to use it. And what that allows you to do is control multiple devices with the same trackpad and keyboard. So if I take my mouse here or trackpad, just move over to the left where there's an iPad, give it a second, it recognizes, and then sort of comes through to the display on the iPad. I can click on Safari and then click on whatever I want. Click in here, type apple.com from this side, and it will type over here, hit return, and we're there. In reverse, we can use the same thing with the Magic Keyboard. Go back over to our Mac, click on Safari, maybe type in Apple. You'll see it works. So again, we can do that in reverse. Now it works universally between both devices. So we can go back and forth. You can also use a third party trackpad or mouse while you're doing that. If you have this docked or anything else, you should be able to use it. So it works seamlessly between them and it's active now. It just works and it works really well. So I'm glad to see that's finally here. Now, additionally on the iPad, there's a new option in Control Center. So if we go to settings and then we go to Control Center, you'll see we have the option for keyboard brightness now. So if you have an attached keyboard, you can brighten the keyboard on it. So if I connect it to my Magic Keyboard and we go to the Control Center, you see I have a keyboard backlight option. However, I can't use it because the lights are on. If I turn the lights off, give it a moment, it realizes the lights are dim, and now I can control the keyboard brightness on and off or up and down. So that's something they've added with 15.4. So it's great to have all of those features. They're listening, and that's something I've wanted for a very long time, is a way to easily control the keyboard brightness without going directly into settings. Within the iPad, if we go into settings and then scroll down to notes, under notes, we can now change the corner swipes. So you'll see it says corner gesture and then left corner swipe, off, quick note, or screenshot. That's for notes itself. Before we could do this for Apple Pencil and they had it in a different area, now they have it within notes also. In this update, they've added additional features for the PS5 DualSense controller. Before, we could use this via Bluetooth to control our games, whether that be Call of Duty or something else, but now there's firmware that allows us to use the DualSense adaptive triggers. So game creators can update their games to allow you to use those DualSense adaptive trigger features. If you've ever used this, you know these are the best triggers out there when it comes to haptic feedback and more. So now they can do that. So hopefully we'll see that added to different games online, whether that be Call of Duty, Minecraft, or anything else. Apple has also updated Keychain with an additional feature. So if you go into settings and you go down to your passwords, I created a test password just so you could see this here. We now have the option to add a note. So we can add a note within our test password, and this is not a real password for the website, but you can add a note in here if you want to say maybe this is an old password, or maybe you need to keep track of something like that. So you can just keep a note of whatever you need within Keychain now. Also to do with passwords, passkey sign-in on websites is now available as long as it's enabled by developers. So what that means, according to Mac Rumors, is that websites that allow for authentication via Face ID or Touch ID allow you to authenticate with an iPhone instead of having to enter a password now. So that's something that you'll be able to do with this. Within apps that use SharePlay, such as music, you can share directly from the sharing options. So if we go to the options in music, you'll see it says SharePlay at the top. Before, it would just say share song. So now there's actually a SharePlay option built into this and any other app that allows you to use SharePlay. There's also a new preference within your TV settings. So if we go into settings, go down to TV, under TV, scroll to the bottom, you'll see it says device preferences. Up next display. So it says allow TV shows and movies played on this device to influence your For You recommendations. And then you have these options here. So show sports scores, use play history, and up next display with still frame and poster art. So that's a new update or option within this update. Also within settings, if we scroll down and we go to Safari, within Safari, scroll down to the bottom, you'll see advanced. Under Advanced, we have Experimental Features. Scroll all the way to the bottom, and we have Reset All to Defaults. Thanks to my friend Matt for sending this in. And as you can see, it says Reset All to Defaults. On the previous version, you don't have that option. So maybe you forgot what you turned on or off. Now you can just reset it all back to default. A nice little update. When you open up AirPods, it's a little bit different now. The little floating screen that pops up looks slightly different. It has more bold text and the overall look is a little bit different. Thanks to Alessio for sending this in. Within the European Union, Apple has added the ability to add a vaccination record to meet their standards now. Now, this is available in most European Union countries, with the exception of Switzerland, Liechtenstein, Cape Verde, North Macedonia, and Palestine. Those should be added eventually, but as Apple works with governments around the world to add that, those will be available later on. So those should be available within this update and when it's released to the public. Now, there's some resolved issues in this update as well. There are 7 resolved issues, typically having to do with Xcode and some fixes for developers. So nothing really user-facing, but there are some fixes there with Swift UI and more. There's also 13 known issues and a few notable ones as well. So if you're using Emergency SOS with the 5 presses, that's disabled in Beta 1 with the exception of India, as there's a problem where it unintentionally defaults for some users. So if you're using that SOS feature or that's very important to you, I wouldn't update to this beta. Within the Home app, if you're using Home with thread-based accessories and trying to add a new one, in Beta 1, it doesn't allow for pairing thread-based accessories using that communication standard. Also, some Matter-based accessories may not work in Beta 1. Also, within Messages, if you press and hold on an image to quick view it, going back and trying to scroll sometimes doesn't work. So that's a problem. They say to fix that, exit out of the conversation, go back in if it's not allowing you to scroll. So those are some notable things. There's 13 total known issues. So there's no mention of anything as far as the storage bug or music bug or anything like that. So if we go into settings and go to general and then storage, for some people, it seems to be resolved in 15.3. For others, it doesn't. And based off how slow it's loading here, I would say it's still a concern. But now that we have the feedback app back, we can report feedback. So that's the first time I've gone into storage. It's taking a while. We definitely need to report that in feedback. Also, like I said, the music bug and pink display bug is not showing up as far as something is being resolved yet. So that's when your phone sort of crashes and reboots or resprings. Sometimes the display will come up pink and then show you that and reboot, or pink or purple. So no mention of those fixes, no mention of the music fix where it uses additional CPU cycles, but we'll have to wait and see if they fix that throughout the beta updates. Now, it just finished installing on my iPhone 6S Plus. Like I said, this has got the wallpaper from the one the other day. Let me go ahead and log in and let's see what the performance is like, because this just rebooted. So I can share with you in real time what it's like. So we'll go back to listen now, give it just a moment to see how it loads as everything sort of boots up and starts indexing in the background. You'll see it's actually quite smooth as we scroll through. So not too bad there. If we go over and maybe see how frame rate is in Minecraft, I typically like to use that app. We'll give it just a moment to load here. Now, it took a little bit to load, but frame rates is what we're looking at here, and it seems to be pretty steady. So right after rebooting, when it's typically working the hardest, it's quite warm at this point, but frame rate seems steady there. But the overall heat while installing it, it will warm up quite a bit. That's typical when you're installing an update. Plus, I had it plugged in, but it seems to be responding quickly and performance seems to be pretty decent. Now, as far as battery life, we'll give this just a moment to run the benchmark so we can check those in a moment. Let me close the other apps here. I'll just show you in real time. We'll let it run here. We'll go into Geekbench. We'll let this run and let's take a look at battery life, because battery life is going to take a few days to sort of figure out what it's doing, but I've been using 15.3 and you'll see that storage bug is still going on. So there's definitely an issue there. They haven't fixed that, but battery health on this device is 100%. And someone asked me to show battery health on other devices. So here's battery health on the iPhone 10, 88% after a few years of being used. And it was used by my daughter for a little while after I used it. And typically battery life takes a few days to measure, but on 15.3 yesterday, I had 4 hours and 18 minutes of screen on time, 14 hours and 55 minutes of screen off time. Music used 11%. I think that's due to the bug, as I used it maybe for 15 minutes in the background, but I used about 60% of my battery. So battery life is okay, but that music bug is still there. If I wasn't using music at all or just closed out of it and didn't stream, this probably would improve. But most people say 15.3 is better. And again, I'll have a follow-up with more information this weekend. Now, as far as performance, let's take a look at those Geekbench scores. So on this device, it's still running on the 6S Plus, but on the 13 Pro Max, it scored 1,729 for single core, 4,709 for multi-core. If we take a look at the CPU history, on the 22nd, it scored on the RC version, is the last time I ran it, you'll see it's better than the RC with single core and multi-core. So it's actually doing quite good. It's within the region for error, but it's quite good. No problems there whatsoever, and is performing really nicely, and it's nice and fast. Let's take a look at the Geekbench scores on all these devices as soon as it finishes on the 6S Plus. From left to right, we have the iPad Pro 12.9 from 2021, followed by the iPhone 6S Plus, then the iPhone 10, iPhone 11, and iPhone 13 Pro Max. These are all of the scores that were run right after updating, so these could improve, although these seem to be pretty typical now. They don't seem to improve too much after a few days from 15.3 experience anyway. So if you're anywhere around these numbers, you should be good to go. And that leads me to, should you update or install iOS 15.4 Beta 1? I would say if it's on your main device and you use it for productivity or work or anything else, probably skip this and wait till the second beta, as early betas have a few bugs like the ones I already mentioned. However, if you have a secondary device or one that's not as important, you could definitely try it out. However, I typically say make sure you have a backup and a computer to roll back to the public version if you need to do that or experience problems. If you're trying to maybe update to it because you're having a problem with a public version, it's never a good idea to update to a beta just because you're not going to resolve those issues. Betas are to test for those issues. So you want to report and feedback and sort of see what's going on and help Apple fix the software if there's bugs in it. So otherwise I would say no on a main device. If you have an extra device, you could definitely try it out. Now, as far as when to expect iOS 15.4 beta 2 and a release, based off of what we see normally with betas, usually within 2 weeks. I would not expect a beta in the first week of February here, probably the week after that. Apple, of course, can always change this, but typically with early betas, beta 1, beta 2, we won't see weekly updates. We'll see bi-weekly updates. Then maybe a final release sometime in March. So maybe we'll see that before a March event or something along those lines, with major new features coming in June with iOS 16 at WWDC. So don't expect too many changes, although this update is a pretty great update so far, and they'll probably add even more with beta 2. If you've found anything more, please let me know in the comments below. And of course, if I find anything more, I'll let you know in an update video with maybe more new features and things like that. There's definitely going to be a lot of little things throughout this OS, as I'm seeing a ton of it in the notes with thanks to my friend Steve Mosier. So lots to go over here, and it's going to take a couple days to figure out everything in it. If you'd like to get your hands on this wallpaper, of course, I'll link it in the description like I normally do. And if you haven't subscribed already, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.